Hey there, friends, playing some Tailspin for the Nintendo. Great game that I had when I was a kid. I was never too good at it when I was a kid. I don't ever remember getting past, like, the second level, I think. It is a side-scrolling shooter, kind of slow-moving, somewhat kid-friendly one, though it is still kind of hard. This is a game that I got, like, later on in my NES playing life. I think by the time I got this, the Super Nintendo was already out and everything. It was probably the last one we ever got, I think. Probably my mom found it in a bargain bin or something. We liked it and we played it, but it was too hard for us. I kind of wonder why. Like, it's not that hard. We got stuck, like, in the second level somewhere. I don't know. We couldn't figure it out. These guys always get me. Gotta get that cash money. Yeah, just having the little pea shooter in the beginning is so annoying. Your gun gets better. Flying backwards is kind of a double-edged thing, because you're gonna, like, respawn enemies. But it is a cool mechanic, though. I don't know of, like, any other shooters where you can do that. Just, like, flip the screen direction. I know of shooters where the screen starts moving backwards, but not where you can control it. This submarine guy coming up here. Got him. Yeah, this level we could never beat. It's not that hard, now that I play it as an adult. I'm thinking a lot lately about nostalgia. It is, after all, right now, the middle of a global pandemic. I'm indulging some nostalgia, you know, by playing this game and a lot of other Nintendo games right now. I'm sure a lot of people are doing the same. There's something about, you know, times of uncertainty that give rise to nostalgia. It's a pretty universal human thing, from what I can tell. So what exactly is nostalgia? I studied psychoanalysis in grad school, at least, you know, I was an English major, but I was really interested in psychoanalysis, and really the only way to study psychoanalysis in the United States anyway is to be an English major. And in psychoanalysis, they talk about, like, this universal experience of loss that all humans share in common. Well, most humans. Because everyone goes from being an infant and existing in this kind of paradisical state of oneness with the mother, you know? You're not an individual yet, you don't have a consciousness yet. You're just kind of a blob of sensations. And it's bliss, you know, it's ignorant bliss. But obviously doesn't last forever. Everyone has to leave that state if they are to develop a functioning human consciousness. You know, separate from the mother figure, become your own person. And this is traumatic for everyone. It's the universal trauma of existing. you know, you have to go from having your reality completely undivided by words to the world of language, where you're a separate thing from the rest of the world, you know? Not easy for anybody. And I think nostalgia is hearkening back to that universal, that state of oneness with the universe that we all experience as a baby, you know, like, at least like on its most basic level, that's what it is. Nostalgia has certainly been a part of, you know, a powerful force in my life. I mean, I was nostalgic for, like, the Nintendo when the Super Nintendo was out, you know, when I was just a little kid. You know, okay, let's see how much money do we have here. Sure, parts for the engine. The Fiend. So we're getting back to nostalgia. I have to think, I mean, the NES is a powerful nostalgia engine for me. And I know that it is for a lot of other people too. And sometimes I have to think that, like, nostalgia has existed forever, but maybe it's, there's something different about it now that, really starting with people about my age, I was born in 1989, we had kids growing up with this completely immersive entertainment experience that before the Nintendo, there really wasn't anything like it. You know, books have been around for a long time, and there was the radio and movies and, you know, older video game systems like the Atari and stuff, but nothing quite like the Nintendo and its immersiveness. You know, the music, the colors, the gameplay, the sound, really, it was like entering a fantasy world, truly, in a way that no one had ever experienced before. And, you know, people about my age are the first people to have grown up with something like that for their whole lives. And maybe it's a unique thing in human history. I don't know. It's a theory. What effect would this have on us? Well, we do see a generation of kind of, you know, stunted in its development somewhat. A lot of people are addicted to video games in particular. It's hard to break the spell, you know, once you come under it. Fuel for nostalgia, especially when you're a kid. I mean, everything is more fuel for nostalgia when you're a kid, but just like I was saying, the full experience of video games, the music, the sound, and the fact that you're participating in a fantasy world, I mean, it's something that was a new experience, you know, in the 80s. Okay, let's try that again. The chandeliers always get me, the way they explode down there. it can be dangerous to indulge nostalgia. Carl Jung, another, I guess he's the first one I've mentioned, so he's not another one, but, you know, you probably recognize his name, famous psychoanalyst. He talked about, malignant nostalgia, a sort of dark force in your life that, something you latch on to stay put and not grow up. I've noticed times in my life when I've really wanted to not grow or change. Nostalgia has been, prior to that, you know, hook up the old Nintendo and play through Super Mario World again. But I do spend a lot of time with the Nintendo and Nintendo games, and I do think it's a healthy habit. It doesn't have to be malignant. You know, in some ways, I think my retro video game hobby is kind of a healthy way to contain the nostalgic impulse. But what is bad about it? It seems intuitively bad to be clinging to the past. It's kind of deadening, you know, not engaging with the present, not growing or changing. I mean, I don't want to be like that. But I just can't get over the Nintendo. I love it. It's just like this endless well of enjoyment for me. And, you know, don't let, you shouldn't feel bad about it. I shouldn't feel bad about it. Neither should you. If you like playing retro games. It's a harmless hobby. No one's suffering for this. I'm not wasting all my time. It's a really good thing in my life. Get me, ghost. Such a huge community of people online still devoted to the NES. You know, clearly it has a hold over us. Let's get that rapid fire going. Super rapid fire. Yeah, I do think nostalgia is a healthy thing to indulge. You know, if you're like me and you have a natural tendency towards it, developing a sort of healthy hobby, collecting, something like that, as long as it's not having a negative effect on your life, go for it. People are into some weird stuff, and it's all good. pretty good music in this game. Really good graphics, too. This game just, like, it's aesthetically pleasing to me. Going around collecting treasures in the sprightly colored Wonderland. Not like DuckTales. It's just a pleasant experience. You know, Capcom and Disney really, like, knew what was going on. Made some good stuff together. Nostalgia truly must be a universal human experience. It seems to just be part of the way that human consciousness is structured. You know, we all experience loss and we all hold on to it. We're all trying to kind of reclaim the past, this, you know, idealized moment that never was. You know, how many movies and songs and things have you heard that talk about that very experience? Something that never was. Childhood can be pretty great, though. I mean, sometimes it does seem truly sad to have lost childhood. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people know what I'm talking about. I mean, just the total lack of responsibility, sort of lack of the guilt of freedom, you know, of being responsible for your own life and your own well-being. So many people I know talk about this, like, constant sense of guilt about wasting time, not being productive. But when you're a kid, you don't have that. At least I didn't. And that's truly a lamentable loss. You know, just to have everything provided for you. It's hard not to idealize that state. Adulthood has its perks, though. Like, what is great about adulthood? Freedom. Freedom is a double-edged sword, guys. You can't have freedom without having anxiety. You can have sex and relationships when you're an adult. At least most people can. Can't do that when you're a kid. At least, not most kids. Capcom is really known for kind of recycling a lot of that content, you know, like all the Mega Man games seem like they were just kind of cranked out, like, all at once. You know, DuckTales 2 is like the same as DuckTales. There's a lot of similarity in their games, but it's good, they make good games. They're not my favorite, though. Konami might be my favorite, at least when compared to Capcom. A lot of Capcom games, not necessarily this one, but like Mega Man, they just have this kind of like cold, like mechanical, robotic aesthetic to them that doesn't appeal to me. It's like Mega Man can never be like Mario to me. Mario is just so like welcoming and comfortable and safe. And Mega Man is not really like that. It's kind of like cold. I like the Mega Man games, but they're never going to be Mario. Oops. Got smooshed. Capcom's Disney games, though, are not, like, cold and mechanical. I totally shied away from Disney games when I was a kid. I guess I just thought they were lame. I don't know. I didn't give them a chance. I didn't think they could possibly be good. I mean, I had this one. But I didn't really think of Tailspin as a Disney thing. Like, the Disney movie games, like Aladdin and Lion King, even though those are good games. I don't know. They just seemed lame to me. Just some commercial movie product for kids, you know. Pretty cool how you can, like, ricochet bullets off stuff. That only really happens during the boss fights, but I like it. There aren't a lot of, like, kids shoot 'em ups. At least that I'm aware of. Tailspin is one. Very satisfying sound effects in this game. I'm trying to hit something. Yeah, like, even this is reminiscent of, like, the Amazon level in DuckTales. Maybe that's just because I was playing DuckTales today, but I don't know. These Capcom games. They certainly knew how to make good use of their time and resources, I guess. I do remember the Tailspin TV show, but not all that clearly. Like, I don't recall any particular episodes or anything. I remember, like, his little buddy and his little hoverboard thing, and, like, his wife or whatever, whoever she was, and, like, the bad guy, Don Carnage, the coyote. I remember really liking that show and the theme song. Along with, like, Chip and Dale and DuckTales again, and those other Disney shows. Now, you know, April 2020 is an okay time to be indulging your nostalgia as much as you want. Or I'll just get into this. State of oneness with the universe and then clinging on to nostalgia. that almost makes the Nintendo a sort of window into this early experience of oneness with the universe, you know, which you had in childhood because you were not yet aware of your own existence as a separate being, which sort of gives me hope about life in general, because it shows you that, sort of undivided natural experience of just existing is bliss, if you can allow yourself to experience it. And could it be that the Nintendo can be a window into that experience? I don't know. Just saying. Bullet Hell is a game that I can play down Carnage. Thanks for watching, friends.